amazing. I thank God right now for what he is going to do in this place, opening hearts and minds. He's fixing conditions.
Holy Ghost, thank you right now. We celebrate your work. We celebrate your authority. We know the power. We appreciate the power of your name, Jesus. We plead the blood, and we thank you for every crooked place being made straight.
He's fixing conditions, solving problems, making every crooked place straight.
Isaiah 53:4-8a, also verses 9 and 10. God bless you. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken and smitten of God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes, we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed, and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter. And as a sheep before his shearers is dumb, so he opened not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment. And who shall declare his generation? The word of God now in Isaiah 53:9. The prophet Isaiah records, he made his grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, because he had done no violence, neither was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed. He shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Now our final scripture, Matthew 27:50-51. The Bible reads, Jesus, when he had cried again with a loud voice, yielded up the ghost, and behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom, and the earth did quake, and the rocks did rent. Say amen. Amen. From these passages this morning, I want to speak on the subject, I know it was the blood. I know it was the blood. Charles Spurgeon once was quoted as saying, it was no small miracle that tore so strong and thick a veil. But it was not intended merely as a display of power, as many lessons have taught us. Thus, the old laws were put away, and like a worn-out jacket, they were laid aside. But when Jesus died, the sacrifices were all finished, because all was fulfilled in him. And therefore, the place of their presentation was marked with an evident token of decay. Therefore, the tearing of the veil also revealed all of the hidden things of the old dispensation, the stuff that was under the blood, the stuff that you don't want us to know about. And amen, now we see that the mercy seat could now be seen and the glory of God revealed and gleamed forth from above. And by the death of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we come today to the realization that we have a clear revelation of God. For he was not as Moses, who put a veil over his face. For his life and immortality are now brought to light. And things which have been hidden since the foundation of the world are now manifest through Jesus. We find the annual ceremony of atonement was thus abolished with the atoning blood, which was once every year sprinkled within the veil, now offered up once for all by the great high priest. And therefore the place of symbolic rite was broken up. No need to go through changes any longer. No need to be troubled with all of the rituals, for the blood has given us the right to the tree of life. Amen. Yes, the veil. Today we remember the veil. The veil has now been rent for us. Therefore, we, through prayer, through praise, through seeking the face of God, through fasting, have access to glory, to greatness, to mercy, to goodness, to kindness, to tender-hearted behavior, to right motives, to good sense. Amen, somebody. The veil is described as a derivative of the Latin word velum, which meant a curtain or a drape or a cloak or a mask used to conceal or to cover our sinful breach. Amen. For the Bible describes the veil as a curtain separating the Holy of Holies. In the New Testament, 2 Corinthians 3:13 through 16, we find that through Jesus Christ of Nazareth, the veil was rent from top to bottom, signifying that the barrier that was set up at the very entrance of the divine, the middle wall of partition we were told about back in the day, separating the clean from the unclean, and the profane from the sacred, the darkness from the light, the pure from the impure, concealing the full revelation knowledge of the Old Testament, and that by Jesus' consecrating the way through flesh, the veil was taken away. Amen. Thus the Bible records for us in the book of Hebrews chapter 10, verse 19 and 20, that the one and only entrance into the Holy of Holies, the place of our God, the place of the sacred, the place of the clean, the place of the pure and the divine, is through the sacrificial blood of Jesus. We've come today to rejoice in the blood. We've come to thank God for the blood. Clap your hands and thank the Lord for the blood. The blood of Jesus. The blood. Blood that trickled down through 42 generations, that precious blood, the blood that picked you up from wherever you were, washed away your sins, opened your eyes, gave you a new and consecrated way of living, that precious blood, that powerful blood that reaches from breast to breast, that blood, amen, that powerful blood, that day by day continues to give us strength in the time of storm. It gives us hope and it gives us help in the darkness of night. It will never, ever lose its power. Songwriter talks about the blood, says it reaches to the highest mountain and it flows to the lowest valley. The blood that gives you and I strength from day to day. We understand. Folk misunderstand the blood, but we realize that it will never, ever lose its power. That blood, rendering now the veil, amen, that gives us access to the throne of grace. And the blood of bulls and the blood of lambs is no longer necessary. For Jesus has entered within the veil with his own precious blood. Hence, access to God is now permitted and is declared the privilege of every blood-bought believer. Don't you doubt the power of God to make a way. Don't you doubt the blood of Jesus to handle business on your behalf. Don't you ever think that anything is impossible with God. If the blood is on it, you just wait for God to handle it. You wait for God to manifest because it's already done. Tell God thank you. The blood has given us permission to get excited ahead of time. The blood has given us, amen, a way, amen, out of our storm. The blood will put dancing in your feet and clap it in your hand. The blood will give you better sense than to believe the report of the doubters, the distractors, and folk that don't understand your way. The privilege of the blood is given to every blood-bought believer today. And so no longer must we stand on the outside looking in. Amen. No longer do we have to scratch our heads and hope and gaze and wonder why. Wishing for prayer and the blood give us access. Prayer is our privilege. We have access. No wonder God has given us to know that hallelujah is the highest praise. Because when the blood is on your life, you can shout hallelujah ahead of the storm. No longer, amen, is there a small peephole through which we anxiously peer at the mercy seat. Amen. But the rent reaches from top to bottom, that we may all come to the Lord with boldness. For the word says, come with boldness to the throne of grace and receive help in the time of trouble. Some say that the opening of the Holy of Holies was as of the opening of the gates of paradise to all the saints by virtue of the passion of Christ. For our bleeding Savior has the key of heaven, and with it he opens a door that no man can close. For our bleeding Savior has the key of heaven, and with it he opens a door that no man can close, and lets us enter in with him, to sup with him. He says in the book of Revelation, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man will open the door, I'll come on in and I'll sup with him, and he with me. Amen. And so he lets us enter in with him into the heavenly places and sit with him there till our common enemy comes to the realization that God has made him a footstool. Until God shut the devil's mouth. Until God show up and show out on our behalf. And that's why, amen, through the darkest of storms, we get beside ourselves. Amen. When the clouds, amen, blanket the sky. Amen. Clouds, amen, just hanging low. We sing Zion songs. We move our feet. Amen. We flip through the scriptures. Amen. We talk to ourselves. We lift our hands to God because we have another understanding. Amen. Our circumstances speak a certain language. Amen. And that's one thing, and that's fact. Amen. But when faith is faith with fact, amen, there's no comparison because God got a way to bring his people out. Glory be to God. That's why David said in Psalm 141 and 2, Lord, I cry unto thee. David said this because it was personal with him. He said, let my prayer be set before thee as incense, and the lifting up of my hands as the evening sacrifice. Often David offered prayer in intimacy. But there was another man, amen, that found it comfortable to praise God and to pray in a corporate setting. Amen. He wasn't ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, nor was David. But this man is called Ezra. And in Ezra 10 and 1, the Bible says, now when Ezra had prayed And when he had confessed, both weeping and casting himself down before the house of God, there assembled unto him out of Israel a great congregation of men, women, and children. For the people came, and the people knew what to do. Because the Bible said the people came and wept bitterly. In other words, they poured out their complaint before the Lord. Their hearts needed some help, and the only one that could help them was God. And so they gave their situation into the hand of the master. I was told as a child, he sits high and looks low. No problem catches him by surprise. No situation is too hard for him to solve. He's got a way to fix it, amen, no matter what it looks like. And so Ezra, amen, amen, commissioned that all the people would come together, amen, and unify and offer unto God a word of prayer. Isaiah 42 and 22 speaks of our generation. However, a generation, amen, that finds other avenues for solving their issues. Those that choose not to pray. Those that choose not to face their situation with the reality that there's no greater help than God. Isaiah 42 and 22 says, we are a generation of people robbed and spoiled. They are all of them snared in holes, and they are hid in prison houses. In other words, in the place of bondage, laden with iniquity, bound by sin. They are for a prey. And none delivereth. The Bible says, for a spoil, and none saith, restore. In this very hour, folk are drying up on God. Amen. They're throwing in the towel, dying right in the churches. No fasting and no praying. Amen. And the brook is drying up. Bible speaks of it as a day of murky and muddy water. But the prophet Amos in 8:11 says, behold, the day comes, saith the Lord, that I will send a famine in the land, but not a famine of bread nor of thirst, nor a famine of water, but of hearing of the word of the Lord. And if you notice, we live in a day and time when there's a whole lot of stuff going on. There's a whole lot of talk going on. But where is the word? There's a whole lot of philosophy. There's a whole lot of science. There's a whole lot of facts. Amen. There's a whole lot of statistics. But where's the word of God? No longer, amen, do we need, amen, to attest to the fact that the enemy is in control of our life and giving us access by way of philosophy or the way of malicious jargon, the wisdom of this world. But we need to come to the understanding, amen, that we have a personal relationship with God. And no weapon formed against us shall prosper. No wonder the songwriter sang a song. He encouraged himself. He said, I'm pressing on. Amen. The upward way. New heights I'm gaining every day. He made it personal. He said, still praying as I'm onward bound. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up. Lord, let me stand by faith on heaven's table land, a higher plane that I personally have found. Lord, I need you to plant my feet on higher ground. Psalm 61, 1 and 2. He says, hear my cry, O God. Attend unto my prayer. From the end of the earth will I cry unto thee. And when my heart is overwhelmed, this is what I need the Lord to do. Lead me to the rock that is higher than I. Amen. The rock of my salvation. You need to know that the blood is your access to the rock. The rock that is the strength of my life. The restorer of every breach. My peace in the midst of storm. My help, my hope, my high tower. My foundation, old folk told me when I was a child, it is your shield, your sword, your buckler. Amen. He got a way, amen, to wrap your situation up. And while you yet laid out calling on Jesus, they said he'll put angels on the run to handle your situation. C.S. Lewis talks about it. He says, God, who foresaw your tribulation, has especially armed you to go through it, not without pain, but without stain. Amen. Isn't it amazing that the blood comes to wash away stains? The blood of Jesus. The blood that'll fix every condition. And because of the blood, we understand that we live a new life today. And that we used to do, we don't do anymore. The blood that prevails in every circumstance. Because if God fixes it this way, amen, the blood has prevailed. Or if it looks like God is just sitting with his arms folded and is not moving, he's yet letting the blood prevail in our circumstance. And because of the blood, we call on Jesus today. Because of the blood, we can dance like David danced. Because of the blood, we can lift our hands, amen, while tears are yet rolling down our face. Because of the blood, amen, we can go ahead on and shout now because we understand that the battle is already fixed. Amen. It's already been won on Calvary's cross. We thank you for the blood that's tied to the living water, which is the life of the saint of God. The light of the Christian, the light of the believer that renews our spirit, that strengthens our heart, that takes us through the darkness of these days that we are dealing with. And we thank God for the blood that gives us the wisdom to seek God in the midst of every circumstance. The blood, amen, that reminds us that there is a way that seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. And so we thank God. Let's take a minute and thank God for the blood. Let's thank him for the blood. Let's thank him for the blood. God reminds us, amen, that God, amen, is with us through every storm. Amen. And that's why we get happy ahead of time. That's why we're not even sometimes concerned, amen, with the natural outcome of any situation. Because when the flesh wars against the spirit, we know where the victory lies. And so we clap our hands and we praise God. We lift our voices and we give God glory because there is a glory that comes from the blood. There's a glory that's attached to the blood. Hallelujah. That's why we find it so easy, hallelujah, to shout ahead of time. That's why we find it so easy to praise God because we come to praise God. Hallelujah. He's worthy to be praised. We understand that the enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Amen. And in our life, in the past, amen, we remember, amen, amen, not having access to the blood. We remember those days, amen, when we didn't have sense enough, amen, to walk right, to make the right choices. We remember those days, amen, amen, when we walked in sin and iniquity. We remember those days prior to the veil being torn and rent. Amen. We remember those days, amen, when we couldn't see straight. Folk were praying for us. People were telling us, come to Jesus. People telling us to lift our hands to God. Telling us there's no problem the Lord can't solve. But we kept choosing our own way. Amen. Going, amen, in a way, amen, that seemed to be bound for destruction. But one day the Lord came. He touched us with the finger of his love. And he said, because of my blood, amen, you can praise me now. I shed my blood just for somebody like you. Amen. And I have given you, amen, to walk in heavenly places. I've given you joy unspeakable and full of glory. I've given you peace in the midst of every storm. I've given you money that you didn't earn. I've given you a cattle on a thousand hills. Amen. I put food on your table, shoes on your feet, and clothes on your back. And God says, I need you in a dark day such as this to acknowledge me in all of your ways. I need you to keep on turning your plate down. I need you to keep on coming together and showing love. I need you to cast aside everything that's not like me. I need you to walk away from everything that's contaminated. I want you to remember the contamination that I delivered you from. Amen. And stay away. I need you to shine the very appearance of evil. I need you to seek peace and pursue it. I need you to let your words be few and seasoned with salt. I need you to walk circumspectly. I need you to keep your eyes lifted to the hills from whence cometh your help. I need you to sing Zion songs in a dark day. I need you to keep on shouting. I need you to keep on living holy. For there is a way. Hallelujah. There is a way. And that way is called the way of holiness. And God says, I reward those that choose holiness in a hellish day. I reward holiness. I reward righteous living. I rejoice, your basata. I rejoice in your salvation. I rejoice in you living a clean life. I rejoice in you choosing the right over the wrong. I rejoice in you standing up straight. I rejoice in you choosing what's good and not what's evil. I rejoice in you seeking peace. Hallelujah. Not being a talebearer, a backbiter, and a gossiper. Not being two-faced and double-minded and wishy-washy and fickle. Amen. Not dependable, not accountable, not reliable. Amen. I rejoice in those that shun distraction, keeping their eyes set on Jesus Christ, the rewarder and finisher of our faith. I rejoice in those that choose me. I rejoice in those that love me, that honor me with a clean vessel, that honor me with a life of righteousness, that love to smile at me, that love to dance in my presence, that love to praise the Nebashai, their Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. For he has made a way. Each to the Nebashai, he's made a way, and he'll continue to make a way. And because of the weight of the matter, a lot of times, amen, all you can say is, oh God, oh God, oh God, oh God. But oh God, oh God speaks to the willingness of God to handle it. Oh God speaks to the understanding that you have because of the blood. Oh God says to the Lord, you want me to take over. Oh God says, I'm going to fix it. Oh God says, the wonders are already made. Oh God says, I'm in control. Hallelujah. I need somebody to help me shout, oh God. Oh God. Oh God. Oh God. Oh God. And the Basha. Now I need you to say, oh God, I love you. Oh God, I love you. Oh God, I love you. Come on. Oh God, I love you. Clap your hands and tell him, oh God. Oh God, we love you. Oh God. Oh God. Oh God, in the masha tio, isen in the ma, isen in the dobo, isen in the masha, isen in the osia. Because of the blood, we have attained the good news. Good news that reminds us of our access. Praise God. There's no hidden agenda. There's no locked door. Just like you see the curtains over there. There's easy access. What you need, God's got it. Whatever you need, God's got it.